Thank you. Thank you, everyone, and welcome, a very warm welcome to this centerpiece talk of our edition of IDFA. Please join me in welcoming our guest of honor, Laura Poitras. Hi, Laura.
Hi, it's really so wonderful to be here.
It is very wonderful to have you. And it's been a long time since we've been thinking we should have you with us here. And then we were very lucky that on the year we decided to invite you, you also finished this brilliant new film, All the Beauty and the Bloodshed. And I think I said this a lot in the past few days, that I believe the title of your film, All the Beauty and the Bloodshed, can be actually a title for all that we do at IDFA. So it's a chance that doesn't happen often, that we can all now meet you, walk with you through your experience, the way you made film, the way you thought about film and about the world. And to do that, I want to begin from the beginning.
Before we go to the beginning, I just want to express how wonderful it is to be here with you, with my dear friend, who I met in Berlin. I think it was 2012, was it? Where after Orwa had been arrested, left, went to Egypt, almost got arrested, left, and then was in Berlin. And I just think it's important to know that the person who's organizing this festival is a filmmaker, and a filmmaker who's put his life on the line many, many times, and what he brings as an international perspective. So it's a great honor to be here and to talk about filmmaking.
Now, how do I continue from here? You wanted to become a chef, Laura. That's what Wikipedia says.
No, I really was. I mean, I was a chef for 10 years. I was cooking for 10 years. That's what I did. I started when I was 18. And did that.
Any specialization?
it also tells you, like, we met in Berlin, I didn't cook one dinner for you, so it's, you know, like, I owe you a dinner. I was doing, I was working in French restaurants. I mean, not unlike film, it's an apprenticeship process, you learn as you go. And so I was working in kitchens, mostly. There were French food, but with different influences. The first chef I worked for was from Tunisia, and he had brought in a lot of influences from that. And then then I worked for a chef who was from Japan. So it was French and Japan influences.
I'm really, really very curious about the shift.
Yeah.
Because there was this moment where you went so much more in the direction of art, film, and then you found where your heart is, and you became the documentary filmmaker we know. Can I ask you to tell us about this little journey of trying to decide what is it that you love to do?
Mm-hmm. I mean, I guess I always was making things. I mean, I always felt that I needed to be creative. I'm not making something, it's bad news. I'm not doing well. But I was working in San Francisco, and I took a course and filmmaking, and that's kind of what hooked me. But the course I took was at the San Francisco Art Institute, which had a tradition of more avant-garde cinema. So my first teacher was Ernie Gehr. I don't know if anybody here knows Ernie Gehr. Sort of, yeah. Yeah, Serene Velocity was the first film he showed in the class, which is a film about a hallway that's shot with single frame. Very avant-garde, there are no characters, there's no necessarily any plot. There was a story because he gets closer to the end of the hallway. He's like sort of changing the focal length towards the end of the hallway. But it was very much coming from a tradition of cinema that is, you know, you film yourself, you shoot yourself, and, you know, kind of solo working. So Stan Brakhage, there's a Maya Deren, sort of that more of that tradition. And so that's kind of how and then I fell in love with it, and it kind of slowly took over. You know, I started working as a projectionist in San Francisco and saw a lot of work. And including actually Titty Cut Follies, which we're screening here, that was screened when I was in San Francisco. So that was the in. It was much more avant-garde filmmaking.
And projection.
Yeah, yeah.
So I think.
Yeah, yeah. Like I remember when the Warhol, like the library, Andy Warhol's library was kind of opened up, and so like projecting Chelsea Girls and all of, you know, his incredible body of work that, and it was a good way to learn cinema, because I would work for different curators, like Kathy Garrett's at the Pacific Film Archive. She'd be like, I'm doing research for a program, so I would just project films for her. So that's how I saw a lot of films.
And then came your first film,
yeah.
Flag Wars.
Yeah.
That is a very courageous, I must say, examination of society. How did that come about?
Yeah, I mean, Flag Wars is really where I learned documentary filmmaking in the way that I do it now. And it was a process I didn't even know that I was entering into when it began. It's a collaboration. It's made with Linda Good Bryant, an extraordinary artist and curator. And we were in a workshop together, and she told me the story. We became close, and she told me the story that she had gone home. She's to her neighborhood in Columbus, Ohio, which she grew up. It was a black working class neighborhood, and it was being gentrified by white gays and lesbians. And she came back to New York, and she described this scene of, you know, going home and seeing the rainbow flags in her neighborhood, and then seeing these sort of black nationalist flags being hung in a sort of very quiet, you know, on the exterior quiet neighborhood. And she just said, like, what's happening? And she asked her dad, and her dad said that it's a story about gentrification. When new neighbors were moving in, they were hanging rainbow flags on their houses. And then in response, the black community that had been living there quite some time, who didn't have black nationalist flags before, thought that, well, if they're going to hang the flags, we're going to hang our flags. And so you see this sort of checkerboarding of flags throughout the neighborhood. And Linda and I, we just thought this was really interesting, and that maybe we could make a documentary. And we didn't really quite know what was involved in that when we set out. But we had... she was interested, we were both interested in how it is that two communities that experience marginalization and violence from the larger society, how do they get along? Like, will their experience of discrimination and violence from the larger society make them better neighbors, or will other forces such as class, money, override those differences? And we were also interested in telling a story that, you know, that there's long tradition, that important tradition of looking at communities and how they're marginalized from larger society. So if that's the black community or the gay community, but what is it? But are they? Is there another side? Do they also perpetuate forms of discrimination against other groups? And so this was the question that we were going in with. And we found out that, unfortunately, I mean, we'll show a clip in a minute, but that the fact that both groups experienced discrimination did not provide a common ground in this particular neighborhood. That sort of, it was a very unfortunate pattern of displacement, and not necessarily recognizing the other communities presence, and particularly the community that was moving in, the white gay community. But that film, I mean, so much, I mean, when I say it taught me filmmaking, I mean, it really taught me filmmaking. I mean, from the ethical questions of how do you, I mean, Linda and I went there, it's a very small neighborhood, she's from there. We couldn't conceal anything. Like, if we were filming with one person, they would see us filming, and, you know, each community knew that we were filming together, navigating the kind of ethical questions. We were, you know, in positionality, obviously, was something that was, we were, navigating the different types of power that people had in this community. I mean, you know, it was really important from Linda's perspective. There's one, the main protagonist is a woman named Linda Mitchell, who owned her home. She inherited her home from her parents, had very limited resources, financial resources. She had other resources, but compared to the people moving in, and how is she have as much agency in the film as her neighbors, etc. So there was navigating that. There was also navigating the actual, like, making a long-form documentary. We had no idea. We thought we could shoot it in the summer or something. You know, 4 years later, we were still shooting. You know, I mean, it was. We spent a lot of time in Columbus, Ohio, and then my dear friends and the great filmmakers, Julia Reichart and Steve Bognar, are from Ohio, and on our first shoot, we. Asked them if they could help with some of the production, and you know that to literally Steve and Julia taught me how to do sound, you know, how to hold a camera and do sound, and literally like giving me classes on how to do that. And I say that just because I've been the recipient of so much generosity from this filmmaking community, and it's just it's a testament, you know, really to, you know, how we sort of pass along. And I also just want to name Julia because I think she's in our hearts right now. So, yeah.
I have so much more to ask about this, but I think if we watch a clip from Flag Wars now, we can continue talking about the experience.
Let me set it up, sort of the cast of characters. So this, we followed Linda Mitchell, the longtime residents, black residents from the community, and then the people who were moving in. And mostly it was white gay men who were buying the houses, but the real power rested with a woman, Nina Masseria, who was the real estate agent, who was, you know, graciously let us film for many, many, many years. And this is a scene, it's a hard scene, it's not, you know, well, we'll just show it.
Looks like it's ready, doesn't it?
Yeah, I'd love to grab that thing. It's such a beautiful building.
It is. It double or what?
Yeah. They won't talk to anybody.
Who's in there?
That's some family has been there forever.
Oh, yeah.
So you tell by the curtains, they've been up forever, too.
Yeah, and the carpet on the front porch.
Mm-hmm. It's a sweet house. The people waiting in line for that one. It's going to get hot. I knew it. And I'm going to sweat. I hate to sweat. These are halfway houses on either end. Still haven't given up their hole to the neighborhood. The last of the few. This, that, and that, you know. It takes care of that block, you know. Let's move down the next block. That idiot that owns the one on 21st and Bride, and that big, beautiful thing that won't say, I'm not selling. But, oh well. He too shall pass, and that may be the only way it sells, so.
Nobody can tell you anything. Jesus said he'll heal your whole house on this thing. You ought to be ready today to call on him. Don't be ashamed.
My main conclusion is that you really did not take it easy on your first time. It's a very complex narrative. It's a very complex reality that you immediately started from trying to tackle, to depict, to make a film about. And you were at the same time learning how to hold a microphone, but you also managed to make this film within the framework of the documentary industry, so to speak. The film was broadcast and it was shown in festivals and it was funded eventually. So what can you tell us about the first encounter you had with that aspect of filmmaking?
Yeah. First of all, I think Kara Mertes is here, who supported the film and broadcasted it on public television in the U.S. I mean, let me step back a little bit. I mean, one of the, you know, we set out with a set of questions, and then it was also a film that taught me about, like, what is story and what is storytelling, right? It's not that we knew where this was going to take us, but we did, ask people if we could follow them over time, and then sort of through that sort of process of sort of surrendering and found the story, you know? Like, we had questions, but it took us some places that we really didn't anticipate it would take us. So, for instance, one of the main threads of the story is housing court, and so this is something where the new neighbors were using the court, this idea of like historical preservation, like if somebody couldn't keep their house quite up, you know, to their standards, they would like go to the housing court and then file complaints against them. So we spent all this time in court, which is not some place we ever expected to be, but it was. I think the point where I really fell, became obsessed or fell in love with this, you just kind of at some point surrender to this process where you don't know where it's going to take you, which I'm thinking of, your work. Like, I mean, let me switch the we're going to screen it here, but Return to Homes. I mean, what was the starting point for that film?
There was a revolution, and there was a very aggressive regime, and then there were beautiful, beautiful young people trying to do good, and we were just going around looking for them. Diana, my partner, came up with this idea that we should call on a few filmmakers we trust and create this collective way of setting up or coming up with seeds, with beginnings of projects. And we spent the next 10 years doing that. But to me, the...
And at the beginning, where did you think it would take you?
To victory that never came, or came with a very different metamorphosis or manifestations. We were full of hope. And it was, I would say it was crushed, that hope. So one had to invent new hopes to continue. So it's about also surrendering to loss and to failure and trying to come up with the next hope and believing in it again and continuing and keeping a slate of hopes, lined up so that if you lose one, you have others, you're not hopeless. And I think, in a way, looking at your career, it is certainly not not less of a fight for hopes, because with every new film, you are again proposing a new hope, a new, like, tackling a new disaster. With every film, you are always critical about something, and you are always trying to push the questions to really challenge the problem in front of you. And it was not you paid a huge cost for that. And that is something that, to me, in a way, let me put it this way, usually filmmakers from the West pay much smaller taxes or costs on their freedom of expression than those who come from other parts of the world. And I am particularly proud that you are the other example, that you come from a democratic country, but then even that country could not take your freedom, could not accept it, and kept challenging you, but you kept coming up with a new hope and kept pushing.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think one of my main jobs is to sort of expose the kind of myth of American exceptionalism, right? I mean, throughout the work, and to somewhat show how power works in different types of ways, or to confront. But I'm very, you know, like we, I think we share this, like, cautious. I mean, the documentary tradition has been used in many different ways, right? And some for better, some for worse. And there is, you know, a dark side to what we do, right? You know, dark tradition of how sort of whatever that sort of falls with sort of maybe an imperial kind of history or colonial history, and how to undo that, like how to interrogate power, how to ask the audience to question themselves, right, and not make it easy, like that it should be. I mean, you know, like a film like Flag Wars. I mean, that's a hard scene for me to show because, you know, I care about this community and I care about these people, and yet, you know, this is this aside to it, or what we saw in what was happening there, that did feel aggressive. You know, that it was about displacing people. It was about not recognizing the people that live there. And yet we also, there were people in the film, including, you know, Nina, where we also try to show, you know, people who are also under threat, you know, barely surviving, and to kind of hold those two things together.
But this is exactly your second film, because 2003, the invasion of Iraq. By 2005, you have already made a film in Baghdad. You went there right away after the invasion, and you chose to go there. So the first question here, that is the question of deciding or choosing to take that flight, get those permits, get there, sit down with your camera and look around, what is the film? Can you tell us a bit about this moment of decision and why would you want to go there at that moment?
Yeah, when I was, Linda and I were editing Flag Wars was when 9/11 happened, and I think we kind of, there was a sense like, okay, this is going to change kind of a global paradigm right now, at least in the sort of contemporary history. And watching the sort of, you know, what was unfolding. I mean, a lot of it that unfolded was unfolded in secret, obviously. You know, there's a lot of things that we now know, like we now know in the days, immediate days after, you know, that the NSA decided it was going to do complete, you know, global surveillance on US citizens. We learned that the torture memos, you know, justifying literally legalizing the use of torture were written in those first days. And then in the first days was this sort of mapping out to sort of clean up this old business, this whole Iraq thing, right? You know, Iraq, which had nothing to do with the 9/11 attacks, but you know, there were some grudges, you know, and you know that there's oil there, so you know, it felt like let's dust off the playbook. And there was this kind of, I think, this you know, movement. I mean, there was this document from the sort of post after the fall of the Soviet Union, the Project for the New American Century, sort of these, you know, American neocons that just kind of mapped out a unilateral sort of like power move of like, okay, we're gonna like, this is like, we've got the globe, we can like redefine what the globe looks like. And a lot of it had to do with where resources were and no longer sort of, you know, abiding maybe by sort of, international rules, right? We're going to be unilateral. And you know, it was in this context that, you know, in the aftermath that of 9/11, that this, like, all this talk about invading Iraq, you know, and, you know, on no link, right, between the two. But, and then just as an American, it was terrifying to witness. I mean, it was terrifying to witness that, you know, that we're proposing this sort of, we're going to invade a country because we think it might do something, right? This preemptive, this use of preemptive, and we're also going to do it in sort of use of this language of, we're doing it to bring democracy, you know, like the obscene contradiction of that, right? That we're going to be occupying you, but it's really just to bring you freedom, you know. Like, this was really hard to stomach. And then there was, you know, the Guantanamo opens in early 2002. So we see the images of, you know, people in jumpsuits being taken there. You know, as I hope everyone in the room knows, Guantanamo's still open, and there's still people there who've never been charged with a crime. And then there was a complete collapse of journalism, mainstream journalism. Like there was such a, you know, parroting of government talking points in terms of thinking about what the US is doing, because we were then all of a sudden the sort of victim of this terrorist attack. And it sort of, I was just sort of watching this world and just thinking that this is really the sort of pivot point that at least that I had witnessed in my life, and that, I felt a need to respond or to say something about it. And particularly around this, you know, this really, you know, absurd idea of like, okay, we're liberating people by like, putting them in cages. Like, this is insane. It's insane, and it's insane that we were, that the press wasn't more critical of it. You know, even to the point where news organizations wouldn't even use the word torture up until recently. Like, you know, the mainstream, you know, the Times and the Post, it was always enhanced interrogation techniques. So, I felt compelled. To make something about what was happening. And when I, originally I set out to make something that documented the US military, I approached them, I just, you know, started, I sent them an email, you know, to put it in context. This was when, Donald Rumsfeld, they were doing a lot of embedded journalism. So there was like the US military takes in these journalists, we protect you, we put you in a tank, and you know, you won't get killed. And then, you know, lo and behold, all the coverage is very favorable of the military. The military is constantly centered, et cetera. And, you know, I reached out to them. So they were kind of like, they had a media office. The door was open to the US military. And I somehow they let me get on a plane. I mean, they actually watched Flag Wars. I had a meeting with a general, and I had a meeting with a general, which was literally the week that the Abu Ghraib photographs were released. You know, the most horrifying. I mean, if you remember that day when you just see these photographs, you know, coming out, and it's just, and he said, and I think he just felt, well, it really can't get any worse than that. Like she really can't show anything that's worse than the Abu Ghraib photographs. And I think that they had this idea of the media when you're on a tight leash, a short leash, which is, you know, you're out there, you're reporting, it's on the news the next day, they could just kick you off easily, because if you're not in line, then they just, you know, stop protecting you, and then you lose your transportation. So I put out a proposal that I was interested in documenting the nation building. U.S. government's nation building, and they somehow said okay, and that's how I got there. And then I, it was kind of a terrifying scene. I was in the green zone. I mean, this is where the U.S. military had their operations, their sort of headquarters, and then the rest of Iraq, of course, was like the red zone. It's all dangerous. And I quickly realized like I couldn't stay inside this zone. Like there's no way that I couldn't, you know, create sort of an echo chamber if I only stayed within this zone. So I started just leaving the zone. And the first time I left, and we'll show this clip, was on a trip to Abu Ghraib prison. So this was in the summer of 2004. The photographs had been released in the spring of 2004. So they were really recent, and there was the Iraqis were outraged about the photographs, and I heard that there was going to be some military outing to Abu Ghraib prison, and I just said, you know, I really want to be on this trip, and they were like, well, what does that have to do with, you know, our nation building? And I made some sort of like very convincing argument, and somehow I get on this. On this trip inspecting Abu Ghraib prison, and it was at this inspection that I met Dr. Riad, who became the protagonist of the film, and he was leading the inspection. I said, can I put a microphone on you? And he said, yes, we want to show what's happening here. We want you to see. So he allows me to put a microphone, and he conducts this inspection, and then after that, I continue to film with him. I continue to leave, but maybe we should show this clip. And so you'll see, there's a bit of a preceding clip that's shot inside the green zone.
Good evening. Thank you very much. I've got a very simple mission here in Baghdad. It was to come and kind of put the stamp on this mission that shows that the U.S. Department of State has planted a flag, and we're going to run this show better than anybody ever thought was possible. And if we're successful, and we fully intend to be, it's an endeavor that'll change the face of the Middle East.
Assalamu alaikum. شلونكم يا خلي يجون الشباب خلي يجون العده مشكله عنده شنو نسجل هي احنا من مجلس بغداد احنا من مجلس بغداد شلونك شلون احوالك شنو اخباركم مواجهه عندك مواجهه عندك وين بيتكم وين بغداد؟
المواصلات
صار لك سنة؟
سنة
بدون تحقيق؟ بابا دقيقة السلام عليكم كم واحد انتو؟ كم واحد انتو؟ وين بيتكم؟ عمرك ايش قد؟ This is type of punishment.
Yes.
This type of punishment, they can't bear it because they are children.
We have looked through every one of these files. These juveniles are dangerous.
I have so many questions, but I'll try to. First is, when I look at this clip, it comes natural to me that we have to lie to them to make a film. That it's not really a valid ethical question whether you had to tell them nation building is my purpose or not. It's enough to see their faces speaking, we'll run the show, to know that you have to.
Right. I agree. I mean, I would lie to film certain things. I have no problem with that. And we can talk about that with the next film as well. But I was interested in, you know, I was parroting back the language that they were, that they had presented to me, for some reason they let me film for 8 months. I mean, really unlimited. I mean, it's kind of like you learn about sort of systems and structures. I mean, the military is very hierarchical, but once you get in, you know, I had a letter from a 4-star general, and I just would show that. And, you know, I walked into rooms. I was in, you know, rooms with like a lot of classified information. I would just walk in and take out my camera, and they would say, like, who's the person with the camera? And they would be like, so-and-so said it was okay. And, you know, in the end, though, it's interesting because of Dr. Riad. You know, this is an extraordinary man. Like, he was a doctor. He was one of the few people who I met who was very vocally critical of the occupation, and yet he was participating in local government. He wanted to participate in Iraqi self-determination, and yet completely critical of what the U.S. government was doing and the way that they were doing it. And in his, you know, his friends and colleagues were being, you know, like, shot every day. Like, he'd go to work, and there would be like another person who was like in the local council who'd been assassinated, because that's what was happening at that point in Iraq. And yet he would still, you know, it was a point at which if you went to someone's funeral, it was an opportunity to, like, you know, assassinate more people. He would be the only person who would go to his friend's funeral, and yet he continued to do this work. And, you know, the film does include this election under occupation, which, you know, I began the film completely cynical of this, you know, this idea of democracy, but yet I had to sort of rethink that cynicism when I saw what he was willing to do, or the risks that he was willing to take and his family were willing to take. So in a way, it does actually present something that is about, you know, I wouldn't call it nation building because the U.S. had destroyed it. I mean, they destroyed the country for generations. I mean, this is, and yet there was something that he and others were willing to risk, you know, more than most people from the United States are willing to risk if they go out and vote. So it there was this sort of shift that I experienced.
Now, on the very personal level, what stays from Iraq with you after all these years? What is it that is your, what did you keep to yourself from that experience?
I mean, you know, this kind of courage. I mean, like Dr. Riad, I mean, he didn't know who I was. He said, you need to come, you know, you need to come to my clinic, you need to meet my patients, you need to, you know, follow this. And to see somebody who was so fully committed to the, you know, his community and the people that he loved, and to sort of witness that happen, you know, and that, you know, as an American, like, what was he like? I was like essentially the occupying part of, like, you know, I mean, here it is, the U.S. is like taking over the country, we're occupying it. I'm a U.S. citizen. He's like, come, we'll take care of you, like, we'll feed you, we will, you know, you'll be safe with us, you know, and yeah.
And you were.
Yeah.
There is a certain level of anger that seems to have started in your filmography from this moment of the invasion of Iraq. It became a continuous hard work on trying to expose a problem that seems to have caused you pain. It seems like you took this also in your own body, like it's not okay to think about something else. You were always trying to look at the source of the pain and address it directly. You were always looking for a person, a protagonist, a carrier for the fight against these different pains, but still, it seems like your filmography since then is every time an attempt to look a source of pain in the eye and keep on it until you what? What do you want to achieve?
I mean, a source of outrage. I mean, when during the war, the reporting, you never, you know, we would read the papers, just be like numbers, you know what I mean? Iraqi, like, people weren't even being named. The people who were dying were not even being named, you know? And then you kind of juxtapose that with the, you know, little memorials that people get when they're, you know, when you're, you know, like, there's something about that that's just, there's a kind of outrage about being, you know, I mean, being from a country that's, you know, engaging in this. And so I don't know if it's so much, is it pain? Is it just like this is, like that maybe that we have tools, that I have some tools, that, you know, the work that you do, that we can do something to maybe shed some light that maybe can. Maybe in retrospect, somewhat naively, right? Like it is, like, look where we are.
I don't think so. I think, yes, I can see where we are, but I don't think it was naive. I think it was a very necessary attempt, and I think we can never measure what reality would have been if none of that was done. I mean, I'm just saying it would have been worse. But for example, the Green Zone in my country, yeah. Your film, you show something that I think was written a lot about back in the day, of how the American soldiers gave streets in the Green Zone American names.
Right, yeah.
And this is something that to me in your film, coming back to it now, because of course we're showing it as part of your retrospective, and I watched it again, and I'm reminded of this, I forgot. But when you go around the part of Baghdad in Iraq, and you know that you're taking a left from Cincinnati to Missouri, yeah, for example.
Yeah.
And you see this in your film brilliantly. What was that experience like to you?
It was staggering. I mean, it was staggering that this, you know, that, I mean, like, one thing I remember is that it was very close to the elections, which is completely U.S., you know, like, we were running the whole thing behind the scenes, and somebody says that, oh, there's going to be a meeting, and, you know, I should go to this meeting, and, you know, I walk in, I start filming, and they said they were going to ask for permission. They never did. Somehow no one stops me. And then it's, so there's all these people like sitting, you know, all these Americans, you know, in uniform, sitting around sort of, you know, orchestrating behind the scenes this, you know, quote unquote, you know, free election, right? And somebody comes up to me and says, you know, from the military, it's like, you know, it might make it look like this isn't being run by Iraqis, you know? And I'm sitting there with my camera, you know? And I'm just like, what do you, you know? I mean, it was crazy. It was crazy, like what, you know, like the narratives people were telling themselves, and you know, quite frankly, it would also felt like important to have a history of, right? That, you know, that I have hundreds of hours of footage of these years, or this year, 2004, of this occupation.
And then you went on to the oath. The film, you went to make in Yemen, and you spent time and you made a film with Abu Jandal, a very, very charismatic, interesting character who was the personal driver and bodyguard of Osama bin Laden at a time when, of course, the name Osama bin Laden was something that really is associated with a lot of pain for American people, for American citizens, not for the big high-ranking politicians and army. But you went exactly the opposite direction and wanted to say, to meet this enemy at that very sensitive moment. How was that? What sent you there?
It emerged, that film almost emerged at the same time as the film in Iraq. I felt like that maybe I should do something about Guantanamo, maybe I should do something about Iraq. Like both of them were just horrifying to witness unfolding. And then I thought, well, I'll do the film about Iraq, and then of course Guantanamo will be closed. I mean, how long can you keep an illegal prison like in another country open with people who've never been charged? I mean, surely that's going to get wrapped up quickly. And when I was editing My Country, it's like, okay, it's still open. It's like, you know, how is this possible? You know, this is going to haunt us. This is going to, you know. So I said, okay, I need to make something about Guantanamo. So I reached out to the military again. This time they didn't respond to me. they just didn't respond. They didn't say no, they didn't say yes. And I wanted to tell a very different story than the one that I ultimately told. I wanted to, you know, there was many, many people who were sent to Guantanamo because it was like a bounty. You know, the U.S. dropped these leaflets on countries and said, you know, if you turn somebody in, you'll get some money. So many people were sent there. And I was looking to document Guantanamo for somebody returning home. That was my intention. And at that time, there were Yemenis were the largest group. They were at Guantanamo, and so that's why I went to Yemen. And very quickly after arriving, was introduced to Abu Jandal, the simple story of the sort of innocent person who was turned in, who was tortured, but a more complicated story and ultimately a much more interesting story. I met him, wildly charismatic. He was Bin Laden's driver and bodyguard, and also ran the guest house. He would sort of indoctrinate young people. And he was driving a taxi cab in Yemen, which to me was really, I was like, what? You know, like, how is he driving a taxi cab? And when we have his people being held, and I was immediately fascinated by him, but I felt it was dangerous as a story. like, okay, what's, no, not dangerous personally, but dangerous as a story. This is not maybe the narrative that the world needs right now. But I couldn't sort of get out of my head. And then for a long time, I told myself I was making two films. One will be, you know, much more politically correct, and then there'll be this one, which would be about this this person. And but what ultimately was, I think, so important about Abu Jandal is after I met him, Lawrence Wright had done reporting on his case, and he was interrogated. He was not, he didn't participate in the 9/11 attacks. He was in Yemen at the time. He was in prison. But after the 9/11 attacks, there was a sort of scramble to talk to people, and he was interrogated. And he was interrogated by the FBI in the September 2001. So this is in the time between the attacks and before we started the invasion of Afghanistan. So this in those weeks, right? I guess six weeks. He gets interrogated, and in that interrogation, you learn, and Lawrence Wright had written about, he does share a lot of information in that interrogation. And so it was actually a concrete example of completely contradicting this idea of using torture, right? Like, here it is, was an interrogation done with somebody, he shares information, and he's never tortured, you know, it's a conversation. And so the US government had, you know, actionable knowledge of somebody, you know, that in the immediate aftermath, that they never needed to, you know, waterboard anyone and create, you know, the black sites that they did and torture people, that this completely, was pure just retaliation, you know, like never, you know, it's not a productive way to learn anything. It was not an easy film. I spent about 2 years going back and forth to Yemen, and I actually thought this is going to be, you know, no one's going to fund this film. Like, this is not going to, it's, and, you know, again, I mean, I have to say that I had tremendous support from the field. I mean, from, at that point, Sundance, other funds, you know, supported this film at a time where, you know, it felt like it was, you know, it was a little bit, it felt dangerous as a story to tell, to make a protagonist somebody who was, you know, unapologetically, you know, this is, he says who he is in the film. I mean, he's still also very complicated, like, to get to the bottom of him. You know, he's very much an anti-hero, and if you're going to, you know, just use sort of dramaturgy language.
I'd like to show the clip from The Oath now, please, and then I think we can look at this part of your filmography together, My Country, My Country, and The Oath. It's a phase on its own. It's a part of a period, as the art language would call it.
تفضلي.
عند السفارة السعودية يمن مول.
يمن مول؟ عرفته. كم بتروحين؟
200.
50.
أنت من فين؟ من السودان؟
لا لا لا. خمني.
سودان؟
لا.
حبش؟
ولا حبش. صومال ابوي مولود في الصومال لكن انا مش صومال احنا يمنيين مش ابوه على طول
نقلوني من كامب دلتا ووضعوني في زنزانة جديدة، وكانت هذه الزنزانة داخل منزل مغلق، ولم يسمحوا لي برؤية الشمس أو الحديث مع أي أشخاص خارج المنزل أو مع أي شخص. إنني وحيد ولا أتحدث مع أحد في الزنزانة، إنه لا يوجد أحد للتحدث معه. إن الشهر هنا يمر كسنة، وإنني أعاني من آلام في الظهر والقدم والهرش نتيجة العزل عن ضوء الشمس.
I should say a couple things. I mean, this sort of also echoes, and this sort of not always being fully truthful of how we were able to film, but I wasn't at Guantanamo. And I have to acknowledge this is the incredible photography from Guantanamo, Kirsten Johnson, my longtime collaborator and beloved friend. And she filmed those images, and you know, we sort of approached it like a crime scene. And then the editor, Jonathan Oppenheim, extraordinary editor.
How was the film eventually? I mean, you mentioned how dangerous the story seemed and how you had to question this all the time, but you went on. How was the film eventually received?
I mean, I really thought, like, oh, this is really going to be radioactive. Like, no one's going to want it. It won't get distribution, you know. It was on public television. I mean, it's really interesting, you know, like, I'm really thankful that, you know, that the work was also ITVS funded. This was funded through ITVS, that's which the public television, one of the, it's sort of the funds independent television in the US. But I really thought this was going to get me blacklisted. This was like not going to sit well. I think that there was, again, I mean, I feel like there was a, there were other filmmakers and some independent journalists that were trying to, you know, do a different kind of reporting about what was happening in the, you know, war on terror and these occupations. I wasn't blacklisted.
Well, I think we will get to the question of whether you were blacklisted or not soon in this talk, when we see how this played out in the near future from then on. But I have a question that's always been a very, I don't know, a kind of a vague question in my head always, that I have to think about now, listening to you and after watching again and again your work. It's a question of belonging and loving your country, your society, your people, like the place you come from. And the fact that there's always this fight or dispute about how do you love? You love it, you're always moved, shaken by what's wrong coming out of the US. You just say, we are invading Iraq. You take share of responsibility without hesitation.
Which is different than love, but go ahead.
But then, this can be seen as an expression of love through being very critical, or what is it?
I don't have a lot of love. No, I mean, I really don't. I mean, tell me where that comes from.
Because to me, it feels like you're always taking responsibility, and by being so critical, you love, you want better.
Mm-hmm. Do you feel that way about Syria?
I don't know about Syria now, to be honest. I know about Syrian people, not about Syria necessarily. You know, how it is now, I don't know. It's something that maybe I need more time before I can really think about. But yes, when I see someone, I think being critical is part of love, not part of not necessarily the opposite of love.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't personally feel a lot of love. I feel that there are like the lies that I don't really want to participate in, and also some, you know, some sense of responsibility, you know. But I don't, I mean, it's not, love isn't, yeah, I mean, this is a public talk, or are you trying to get me now?
I don't know, I'm just trying
to
give
it. I mean, no, believe me, like, I think the U.S. government, you know, has pretty clear idea that maybe they don't think that I have the, yeah.
I think it's just, yes, it's the U.S. government, but you say we, so I
have
to.
Yeah, but I have to, like, I can't pretend that it's, you know, like, I mean, it's a global superpower, and I'm a citizen, so I have to use the word we, don't I?
And then, from here, there was a moment where you discover that you thought you were not blacklisted, but actually you were.
Well, yeah, I mean, this is a different type of list, but yeah, I'm on, I mean, I was put on a terrorist watch list, and I was put on it before I made the oath. I was put on it after I returned from Iraq. The U.S. government, you know, decided that I was a threat to national security, and that they based it on the fact that I was seen with a camera in the red zone. And therefore, I was a threat to national security. And I talk about it a lot. Whenever I do my bio, I always include that I was on a terrorist watch list for a couple of reasons. One, I'm proud of it, in the sense that it means that I'm really doing something, at least that's sort of poking, you know, like it's they're paying attention. You know, the work is causing some discomfort, which I'm proud of, and also in good company of other people who've been surveilled by the U.S. government, and then also because so many people are, because of the fact that I'm white and that I'm a woman and that I'm a U.S. citizen, it allows for people to, you know, understand like that they think, oh well, she's just a filmmaker, right? And then hopefully that can be. Translate when people hear about other, like journalists who actually, you know, were taken to Guantanamo, you know, or innocent people whose they spelled the wrong name, but they were Muslim, and then they were taken to black sites and then dropped into like the, you know, fields in Albania, right? The real horror stories of innocent people who were sort of swept up in the aftermath of 9/11. So I just think it's important I haven't been blacklisted, but I have been put on a terrorist watch list.
When you talk about good company, I find myself thinking about your top 10, about the films that you have selected mm-hmm. to show us at IDFA this year, your curated films. Yeah. Can I ask you about this? Like in overview, of course, we can talk about some of the films in particularly, but generally speaking, how did you think about that? Because I think that has to do with what you're calling the good company.
Good company, yeah. When we first talked, I mean, when you invited me, it's not a top 10 of my favorite films. That's a list I don't think I could make, and I'm a little bit, you know, cautious about those lists. But I did think I could select a group of films that have been indelible, that moved me, that made me think around questions of my role as a filmmaker or questions of representation, and that they're organized around questions of state violence and representation, or how to represent. And they approach this from many different perspectives, and there are also films that have been very influential for me in terms of thinking about making work. And the first that felt necessary politically and because of my love for the film is Jafar Panahi's This Is Not a Film. And as I probably many people in the audience know, he for many years was banned from filmmaking. This Is Not a Film was made well under a ban and was snuck out of the country in a cake and premiered at Cannes. And he was recently imprisoned, and he currently is in prison in Iran. And it's such a beautiful film because of its resistance, you know? And you don't see, it's not a film that you see, the violence, the state violence, is expressed by the means he had to use to make a film, to pretend it's not a film, that the violence is being represented in ways that that are just haunting. And that just felt the most important thing. Okay, if we're gonna do this, we need to talk about Panahi here.
And we are showing the film and talking about it and about Panahi and other Iranian prosecuted filmmakers, but also others from different parts of the world. Another very special film that you have selected was The Three Rooms of Melancholia by Pir Johan Kasalu. Yeah. Can I ask you, how do you relate to this film?
Yeah, I saw it in the cinema when it was released, and it's a film that's in three very distinct chapters, and looks at war and childhood, masculinity, there's the center chapter that's set in Grozny is one of the most haunting moments I've ever seen in a documentary, as a woman whose children, she's giving them to somebody to take away because she's dying. And, you know, just truly haunting in terms of filmmaking. And then also just what the relationships, the juxtapositions that happen between these three chapters. It's just a film that I've, you know, never forgotten.
I'll invite you now to the next period that begins with a message, on online message that you received. So maybe we can watch a clip from Citizen 4 and talk about that.
The encrypted archive should be available to you within 7 days. The key will follow when everything else is done. The material I provide and investigative effort required will be too much for any one person. I recommend, at a very minimum, you involve Glenn Greenwald. I believe you know him. The plain text of the payload will include my true name details for the record, though it will be your decision as to whether or how to declare my involvement. My personal desire is that you paint the target directly on my back. No one, not even my most trusted confidant, is aware of my intentions, and it would not be fair for them to fall under suspicion for my actions. You may be the only one who can prevent that, and that is by immediately nailing me to the cross rather than trying to protect me as a source. On timing regarding meeting up in Hong Kong. The first rendezvous attempt will be at 10 a.m. local time on Monday. We will meet in the hallway outside of a restaurant in the Mira Hotel. I will be working on a Rubik's Cube so you can identify me. Approach me and ask if I know the hours of the restaurant. I'll respond by stating that I'm not sure and suggest you try the lounge instead. I'll offer to show you where it is, and at that point, we're good. You simply need to follow naturally.
As far as positioning, I mean, if you want us to sit in any particular way or whatever.
You know, I'm gonna go there.
So okay.
I get better light. This one. Where the first place?
So, there's, you know, so many different enormous stories, just that are kind of standalone stories, that. Even like, you know, certain things about individual document that can just be their own story. And I just want to start churning those stories out. I basically woke up this morning and already started writing stories. So I'm hoping to, you know, start publishing with him like a day or 2 days.
Okay.
As long as you're good with that.
Yeah.
And so as far as like the stuff we have to talk about, I mean, I'm kind of like dichotomizing it between, you know, stuff that I'd like to talk to you about in terms of like the documents and the content. And Laura has a bunch of questions about that as well. Sort of while we're working through the documents, getting your take on a lot of the stuff that, you know, will help me understand it better. But then also the sort of you story, right? Like the who you are,
yeah.
Why you've done what you've done.
Yeah.
And I'd love to do that first.
Okay.
In part because you're the only one who could do that. So yeah. I'd like to just get it done so that it's done. And also because, you know, it might be that you want to do that early because yeah. it might be necessary or we yeah. might choose to have that done early. Tell me your thoughts on just
so
where you
the,
are with
the,
that.
The primary one on that, and I think I've expressed it a couple times online, is I feel the modern media has a big focus on personalities.
Totally.
And I'm a little concerned the more we focus on that, the more they're going to use that as a distraction. And I don't necessarily want that to happen, which is why I've consistently said, you know, I'm not the story here. nervous.
It's a very, very cheap fan that just the slightest force, bro. Go ahead.
Anything I can do to help you guys get this out, I will do. I don't have any experience with media, with how this works. So I'm kind of learning as I go.
You received a message that changed actually a lot of our lives and the way we understand the world even. It was a bit like a Matrix recognition moment when the revelations came out. And of course, when the story broke out in the newspapers, we all read about it everywhere in the world, in every language known. But we did not know that you were making a film at the same time. You were still in the background of the story. I've always spoken about this film as a unique example of one thing, which is, to me, very, very singular, because by the time Citizen 4 premiered, we have known the story of Ed Snowden and the revelations out of his the documents he made public. And still, I did not discover what was happening through the film, but actually, I suddenly felt comfortable trusting all the stories that I was reading for a while before that, because I watched the film. So the film was not about information anymore. The information was already out there. Mm-hmm. But it had a much bigger value or impact, which was to make me know that I can trust this man and this filmmaker. How was that experience to you, thinking about this point? Because the information, I'm sure you will say the information going out was the most important thing, but the information was out and then the film was not the news anymore in this sense.
Right. I mean, this was, you know, I mean, this scene itself, like we could have chosen, or I could have chosen, or Ed and I could have chosen that we just report the stories. He, you know, there was a way to get us the material without having an encounter. That on many levels would have been somewhat safer for him and for me and for Glenn and for the people who were there. Because meeting came with a lot of risk. And particularly that being all in the same place at the same time, you know, if, you know, if they wanted to shut us down, then that gives, you know, the best opportunity, you know. Well, of course they wanted to shut us down, but if they tried to do it quickly, we would have walked into that situation. So it kind of happened over, you know, this, but I felt really strongly, and I made the argument to Ed, that only he could say why he was doing it, and that it was worth the risk to meet. And, you know, for at first when we were communicating, he was completely anonymous. I had no idea his name, no idea his age, what his job was. And at the beginning thought he would want to remain anonymous, that my job would be to protect his anonymity. And then at some point he said, listen, my fingerprints are going to be on this, so that's not your job anymore. But your job is to report and to get the story out. And I said, well, if that's what you're telling me, then we need to meet. And then there was there was a conversation both about the risk of meeting and then about the danger that he describes of, like, you know, the modern media is interested in personalities and he's interested in the information. So as a source, he was interested in making sure we reported on the, you know, global mass surveillance programs, not that he had a moment on camera. Like, he was not interested in that per se. But I made a very convincing argument that meeting would allow us to also verify things and speak with him as a source that we couldn't do, and that the story was going to be about him no matter what. And so if he didn't do it, then the government would write the narrative for him, for us. If we wanted the government to write the narrative, then fine, then we don't meet. And I'd having experienced what had happened with Chelsea Manning, who was a source for, that we now know is a source for WikiLeaks, was arrested and was, you know, held in solitary confinement and, you know, imprisoned, and we didn't hear anything, you know. Now she's written an amazing memoir that I really recommend everyone read, but it gave the government the opportunity to write the narrative, and I didn't want to do that in this case. I said we should write this, you know, we need to tell what the truth is. And I convinced him. But the scene that we just showed, this was his, you know, this is instructions for the first meeting, which were scary, and it was like sort of walking into some sort of abyss. But then, I mean, the thing that Glenn and I think were like, you know, I think I'm filming here. I mean, I'm in somewhat a state of shock, given like knowing the kind of magnitude and knowing at this point that probably if Glenn Greenwald and I get on a plane, the CIA knows that there's something happening. Like, you know, and at this point, I think they had an inkling that somebody had gone missing from the NSA. They kind of monitor your international travel. But we didn't expect to meet somebody who was 29 in a t-shirt. That was not something we'd sort of calculated, given what he had already told us about the information that he had. And I think we were just like kind of processing, like, who is this person? You know, I think I definitely used the camera as some sort of like, okay, to sort of, hide my sort of anxiety and fear in that moment. I mean, you still see it in the camera work. And then, you know, in retrospect, you know, his youth was wonderful, because people then related, like, why would somebody so young risk so much, you know? And then obviously his brilliance and intelligence and the way he spoke about what he, you know, why he did what he did. And, you know, in this interview at some point he says, you know, like, I feel good in my human experience knowing I can contribute, you know? Yeah, I think that it would have unfolded very, very differently for all of us, you know, if he hadn't already made the decision to reveal his identity and be so brave to do it, because I think it would have been much easier to let others tell the narrative.
Of course, so much to talk about here, but first one is, how was it for you as a filmmaker, the experience of, because in the films before, that was like the work of a dissident filmmaker, of a someone really trying to face problems with courage and so on. But here it became a totally different game, because here you're suddenly in the middle of the world of espionage. You're suddenly being surveilled in a different way. You are under serious risk. Your footage is under serious risk. Anything you do can be intercepted and can be, and there are quite the most powerful people in the world would like very much not to see you finish this film.
Right. Yeah.
So it's a totally different game. It's a totally different world that you found yourself, or you consciously, you know, chose to walk into. How was that experience?
I mean, in a way, you know, this is part of a trilogy, these three films of the Iraq and Guantanamo in this film. You know, I had, you know, thank you to the US government, you know, being on a watch list, I'd learned a lot of tools, encryption tools. So they really trained me well to be able to sort of work in ways that I could kind of protect my information. And, you know, when I was in Hong Kong, every day at the end of the day, I was copying things to an encrypted drive, physically like destroying SD cards, flushing them down the toilet, and then going to a lawyer and depositing footage. Because I figure, okay, if they raid us, if they knock down the door today, then you know I won't lose everything. And it was also very important that the information that was being shared that had been also we had, I don't want to say too much, but created mechanisms so if something happened to all of us, it wouldn't be the end of this information. I mean, Ed would never have met with us if there was the risk of, you know, stopping the reporting. So that had been assured before. But it definitely was entering a sort of a new realm. And it was, you know, there were some, you know, really scary days, and I think I was actually in a state of shock, in those days, and you know, hopefully, you know, making sure that the audio quality was okay, and that I was getting something, but a lot of fear, and you know, Glenn actually had very little fear, so that was, I think, a good balance, I guess. And Ed was like, you know, he was on the other side. I mean, he had, you know, so, like, you know, you can see it, just so calm, and just had already made he'd made peace with his decision and with whatever consequences.
I think, first, I want to say that I am, like many, grateful for you for doing that and for taking all of this difficult challenge, this risk, this difficulty of going through all of this. That was a moment, Laura, when I think your output or your efforts started to be very much more diverse, and by that moment you were not anymore only making films. You co-founded The Intercept, one of the most exemplary for like independent media platforms. You started lobbying and campaigning for different digital and privacy rights connected to filmmakers, but also to citizens, and you started different initiatives. So it feels now, or it seems like making films was not anymore everything you do. You will now have to do more than that. Go more into journalism, into a certain kind of activism or lobbying effort. Can I ask you to tell us about that?
Yeah, I mean, it's in a way, it's simple. Like the information that was shared, there was a burden that it be reported, and that I had a responsibility to make that happen. And I actually want to back up a little bit to sort of draw another sort of continuity. So, you know, before I made this was when Chelsea Manning released the Iraq and Afghanistan war logs and the State Department cables through WikiLeaks. That was a watershed moment. And I feel like it was a watershed global moment of understanding US imperialism and these occupations, and just like lifted the veil. But it was also a moment where the media had, particularly in the US, could no longer swallow government talking points, right? That there was a shift, there was a global shift. And I think a sort of reinvigoration of adversarial journalism that had kind of I think suffered a bit in the immediate aftermath of 9/11, and I think that they did that because of the sort of strategic partnerships. You know, Julian was a genius at this. Just like he will partner with the New York Times, but he'll also partner with the Guardian. He'll also partner with Der Spiegel, and that you couldn't. There was no way to suppress the story, and to me that was felt like so necessary. And I think it also was motivational for Ed and many people who were like waiting for like, okay, where is the sort of adversarial journalism? And sort of also take it outside of like, what is the kind of more elite, where it's expected, you know, that news is coming from other places. It's coming from documentaries, it's coming from other places.
And then you went on to make risk your film with Julian Assange. It is in some way in the same vein or in the same, having similar questions to the questions in Citizen 4, but also Julian Assange and Ed Snowden are not the same person. There's a totally different thing or experience connected to WikiLeaks and Julian Assange. So I'm very curious how you saw that at the time, especially that, of course, you know, we all know how controversial WikiLeaks and the way Julian Assange was working was.
I don't think the reporting was controversial, I actually, but keep going.
Let's watch the clip.
But I want to say more before we show it. First of all, I started that film in, Citizen 4 in a way interrupted that film. I started filming with Julian in 2011 after he started reporting. I was working on, I sort of had moved out of the US because I couldn't secure the footage from border interrogations, and was working, and that's when Ed contacted me, and so I was in this, working on this film about Julian, and Ed was in touch with me, but I didn't ever tell Julian about Ed. And then when we thought it maybe was one film, and then it was in the edit that it wouldn't be possible. I mean, there are sort of elements. And then I returned to it, but I think, you know, as we sit here today, I think before we show the clip, I think it's, you know, important to emphasize the danger right now to journalism because of the US efforts to extradite him and prosecute him for the Espionage Act, which is for his journalism, for publishing truthful information about US occupations and war crimes. And that's what he is being potentially, or that's what the US government has been trying now to extradite him. And I just think it's just, you know, I think it is the biggest threat to press freedom right now, what the U.S. government is doing, and you know, it's also very personal, because everything that, if you read his indictment, are things that I could be accused of, or that another national security journalist could be accused of. So, what he's being charged with, I mean, it's publishing truthful information.
And I think that I'd like to bring up here the point of global or international solidarity at these moments. Because when you're telling us now about the experience of having to encrypt and go to the lawyer and all of the work you've done at that period, now I'm remembering, it's coming to my memory, that when Laura decided after Citizen 4 that she wants to go back to the US, we all around the world, a community of film people and journalists, we were all telling each other, stay alert, tomorrow Laura arrives at this hour to JFK, if I'm not wrong, and we have to be prepared should something happen to Laura on arrival. We are a community and we have to be immediately ready to do something about it. When I was detained in Syria in 2012, the whole point was what Diana, you, Kirsten Johnson, I mean, many of, I will not name people because it was a huge number of colleagues who were friends, but colleagues we also never met or never came across paths, who stood in solidarity. And I think when we talk now about Julian Assange, I don't even think it's relevant whether we fully agree with everything he's done or not. I think there's a key ethical moment here for solidarity, for thinking that it doesn't matter if we agree or disagree 100% or not, there is a clear principle, and that is solidarity in itself, that he has the right. So let's see Julian for a minute in the clip from Risk, please.
I don't believe in martyrs, I don't think. Some very rare exceptions that people should be martyrs, but I think people should certainly take risks to understand carefully what the risks are, what the opportunities of the situation are, and make sure these are in balance. Sometimes the risk can be very high, but the opportunity can also be extremely high. And by opportunity, I mean for things that you care about. we need to keep things in perspective. I mean, there's the risk of inaction is extremely high. And every day you live your life, you lose another day of life. And what's the risk of just sitting there? I mean, you just lost a day. You just died a day. You don't have that many, so... If you're not fighting for the things that you care about and every day is disappearing, then, I mean, you are losing.
He's with us, clearly, listening. Yes. How do you judge your position with such stories like that of Julian Assange or of Ed Snowden? Because we're talking here about the biggest game of spies and intelligence services. We're talking about the most difficult to decipher complexity of manipulation. And we know that every power in the world is hoping to either shut down what is happening, whether it's this story or that one, Ed or Julian, they're all hoping either to shut it down quickly and silence it or to use it against the other. And it's very complicated, muddy. I don't know how to describe it, but how do you see clearly through that and decide this is what I think I should be doing?
I mean, first of all, listening to, you know, and that Julian's current situation is a clear indication that he's perceived as more of a risk than I am right now at this point. I've often wondered with the reporting that I did with the, you know, on the Snowden leaks. I mean, there was a, on one hand I wanted to, and I don't know if this gets at your question, but it's, wanted to not repeat the same things. I didn't want to make the narrative easy for the government to come after us, right? So I wanted to, you know, not give them any opportunities. But I wonder, in not giving them opportunities, did I take as many risks as I should have taken?
I think so. The answer is we keep wondering. Now, we are there by your latest film. We've reached this moment where we speak about this beautiful, big, multi-layered journey that you are taking us on for 2 hours. I hope most of you have watched the film earlier. And if not, of course, there are still a couple of screenings at IDFA. It is, at the same time, a continuity to your filmography. There's a person who is trying so hard to stand against injustice, against an overwhelming power, but this time the person is a brilliant, unique artist, a woman who is unstoppable, but at the same time very vulnerable, but cannot stop. She has to do something about this injustice she sees around her. It's a film that brings together her artwork, her own biography, her own experience, and then also this big mission that she is on today to stand against the Sacklers, the family behind much of the opioid crisis. How did this happen? It's like a new beginning of a new period.
I mean, as you said, there are many overlaps and then some differences. I mean, it's also new, and I'm just finishing it. And then there's this time, and when you're just finishing something, that it's kind of you're still finding the words for it. I'm really proud to work alongside Nan. And this is a film that, you know, she's a collaborator on this film in a way that that is different than probably, obviously Flag Wars was a collaboration, and to she has a lot of the sort of public-facing bravery that I've had in other films, but there's a kind of real emotional vulnerability that she brings that's is really has been extraordinary for me to work with and to be able to tell a story that is both deeply political and deeply personal. And
how does it feel now when you talk about Flag Wars after making all the beauty and the bloodshed? What comes to mind about this now memory that since then everything around us changed, and we changed, and the whole world changed, and you made all of these films. It's fascinating to me to look back this way and watch that film.
Yeah.
How does it feel? Would you make it differently? Do you like it?
I mean, in a way, there's a lot of things in this new film that kind of return, not even before Flag Wars, right? I mean, I when I was studying art first and sort of much more avant-garde art, I was introduced to Nan's work. You know, it's radical. It's not speaking with like a traditional narrative structure. It doesn't have three acts. You know, like there's a lot of things about Nan's work that's kind of like coming home. You know, and to be able and then to make something with like such a fierce female artist who kind of really paved new ground in the art world. So I do. It feels. I mean, people. It is. It's different, but it actually feels very familiar, and it's from the work that I really love and care about. And it is interesting to see these in dialogue, right? To see the work next to each other. But then there's like lots of things that are connected. You know, through lines of just what. A kind of, surrendering to this process. I mean, as the work that we do, it's always a collaboration with the people that allow us to film.
From avant-garde cinema in your beginning, all the way to being a co-founder of a great journalism platform, from different tools to try and incite change or be critical towards all the problems around us. What is it that makes filmmaking particularly an interesting language for you? You've tried so many other things. You seem to keep coming back to this one. What's the point?
this is the one. This is the only one that I actually feel like I have any experience and skills at. I mean, having to work with news organizations to publish the NSA story was necessary, but not my skills. So yeah, I mean, this is what I return to. You know, like what you can say with images, and how images can communicate something about the world that words maybe can't. And maybe that's one of, the things that I keep returning to. Well, if we can just see it, maybe it will change something. Like we know it, we know that, the US is torturing people, we know that, Guantanamo's still open, but if we can just see it, then maybe seeing it will change something.
What gives you hope?
I'm going to turn that back at you.
Many of the first films that I watch and select for IDFA. Because we have this huge palette of a very diverse number of, or spectrum of approaches, of styles, of languages, of political and ethical positions. But whenever I feel cynical or I feel like it's the end of history, one of these come along and make me feel like, wow, this young person believes. Yeah. And it's contagious. It's absolutely contagious. Now you.
No, I agree. I agree. I mean, seeing films, like seeing what other people are doing with the language and with the form is, I mean, I'm thinking last year, Ascension, you know, such a beautiful film that draws upon both, you know, really avant-garde sort of abstraction, but like very hard, you know, political, economic reality at the same time. It's incredible. Such and so formal and so innovative, yeah.
Laura, we have the retrospective of your films and the films you have curated, you have chosen to show us in the program. They're called technically in IDFA's program Top 10, but we know your position towards that.
Yeah.
But anyway, and you're giving us a lot of beauty and a lot of bloodshed to look into over the coming few days. Again, I'm extremely honored to have you with us, and thank you.
I'm so proud to be your friend.